Hey guys, so if you're new here, or if you're not, if you want to hear me voice act, head over to our main channel, links down below. And if you don't, this channel's solely for TTS. If you want to know all the details about what's going on, we have a stream up that you can go and watch, but let's just get into the video.
Be me, Paladin, builder of cities and nations. Because Dahl the Smith, Andre the Fletcher, Peregrine the Chef, Eort the Engineer, Senkit the Consecrator, and Julian the Architect, Paladins of Order Undivided. The party rides hard through the Firewild north and east towards the fairy city of Elvacaran. They ride over seven silver steams, past trees taller than any they have seen before, pines which scrape the heavens, until night falls once more. Their mounts are spent, panting and lathered from the hard day's ride, despite their supernatural endurance. The paladins dismiss them to let them rest, then draw up camp. The party is stiff and sore, but they have made good time, which is crucial. Within the bounds of the Feywild, time is distorted, and there is a chance that even a few days spent here could become months, or even years if the fates decide it to be so. Andre mixes together a salve for their saddle sores, and all sleep heavily. Fortunately for them, no creature comes to disturb their rest. In the dawn they ride on again, until they come to an oddity, a paved road. Despite their great hurry, the party decides to pause for a moment to investigate this unusually developed section. Eort drops off his own roan steed and examines the stonework more carefully. Stranger and stranger, he says as he examines it, then looks up and down the road just to confirm. Yes, these are hobgoblin roads, built to legion standards. Arna took your folk for great builders, oh anything but fortresses. Kazdor says, somewhat surprised in spite of Eort's own work on designing the roads. I thought ye were the exception. No, when we control an area for a while the legions build roads to speed trade and troop movements, but actions like that usually only take place in the presence of an emperor. And the last hobgoblin emperor in this region was destroyed when the humans came and took San Jonas from us. The party starts, and he shrugs as he looks at their stunned faces. Aye, hobgoblins built the city originally, though from the records and legends it was probably only about half as large as the metropolis the United Races made it. You say the hobgoblins only built these in areas with an emperor, could it be that the missing legions came here, and perhaps united under one? Julian asks. It's possible, but I'm not certain. Elvacaran is an elven name, not a hobgoblin one, and if the Ents' information was correct, then this would lead to that city. Eort says with a shrug. Confused somewhat by this new development, the party remounts and continues on their ride towards the city, making good time along the road. At around noontime, they come upon an area that has indeed been cultivated, and beyond it see the towering silver spires of the Fae City. The city itself is relatively small, set upon a single hill, but it is visibly quite dense with people. The roads too are populated, with the party drawing stares, but no outright hostility from the occasional wagon where fair folk, Eladrine mostly, sit and watch. Around the city are cultivated fields of wheat and corn and other such grains, with a few set aside for more interesting crops. Strangers still are the workers. There are a few Eladrine, mostly working the smaller plots that look like family farms of a sort, but the largest fields are filled entirely with hobgoblins. Eort rides on, aware of his people watching him, but not approaching them. He doesn't need to, for he already recognizes the situation. His face is grim set, and his eyes are sharply focused on the city ahead. Kazdor rides up alongside him. Laddie, are ye all right? I'll be fine. I somewhat expected to come across this. Your people. Are these? Slaves. Yes. It appears the Sehd learned a thing or two from us, and not just how to construct roads. It was to be expected, they failed to conquer, and were in turn conquered. Such is the fate of empires. He says this coldly, but a tremor in his voice and quiver in his hands betray his true emotions, though his face is a marble mask. This is nae right, laddie. Kazdor says. Perhaps not, but we cannot afford to act hastily. We will observe, we will get your people out, and if an opportunity presents itself, we will act. If not, then we shall have to return later. For now, ride. Your folk were likely taken for a similar purpose. If we are swift enough, we can buy their freedom and get them out of here. Remember our purpose. I do remember. A need just for Comyn here. Khazdor growls, but he controls himself. Julian looks on worriedly. If the big-hearted dragonborn acted rashly, it would be no end of trouble. The party rides on and approaches the gates of the city, which stand open. The stones are whitewashed, and gleam in the bright summer sunshine. It is quite busy, a hustle and bustle of Eladrine, smaller more exotic fae, even the rare hobgoblin going about their business. The party gathers stairs once again, particularly Khazdor atop his gargantuan steed and Senkit with her plainly infernal heritage, but nobody feels like troubling the heavily armed travellers. As they ride onwards amongst the fae crowd, they look about and see the rampant hustle and bustle of the city. The sights, sounds, and smells of hundreds of people going here and there both on the streets and even above, as Eladrine walk on fine bridges that span the gaps between the high towers. Bloody hell, how the devil is this place laid out? Julian wonders as he looks all about trying to figure out the traffic flow. It's not, it most likely grew together naturally rather than being planned. Andri responds as she reads various signs. Her lip curls as she sees advertisements for a slave auction, confirming Eort's earlier suspicions. Bloody fae, the Arsima mutters. Still, we need to find the dwarves. See anywhere we could start? Unfortunately, yes. Andri responds. As the sun beats down, the party rides around to the other side of the hill, down it towards a rather large amphitheater with a huge track all around it. Eort stops and whistles. That's a chariot racing track. My grandfather told stories about such places, I never thought I'd see one in person though. Aye, that's knee fairy work. The stones too sensibly laid out, Khazdor muses. This must have been a groby city at one point or another. The party rides down, aware of the many eyes on them, but unaware of a few particularly unfriendly sets watching as they descend. Many others come down as well. Inside, there is a massive press of people shouting, clamoring, and the clinking of many coins changing hands. The arena floor is filled with traders selling what would politely be termed labor, and accurately termed people. It's not just hobgoblins, it seems these fae are equal opportunity slavers. Goblinoids are the most populous by far, but so also are halflings, even the rare human or other Eladrine, though those seem to sell for far higher sums. In any case, this is a meeting place for the remarkably wealthy, as even a lowly goblin is going for a full platinum piece. I didn't take the summer fae for slavers. Senkit mutters as she watches the ongoing mess. Her voice is remarkably calm, though it's not entirely surprising. Chulters indeed have a large slave trade, and many Chulters are shipped away to southern Fee Run, to work plantations and construction projects in the desert kingdoms. They aren't, but these are wild V. You never really know what to expect with those. Julian says, equally unperturbed, all manner of traffic comes through Sigil, and slaves are not the worst thing bought and sold beneath the eyes of the Lady of Pain. Peregrine is visibly troubled, but he has wandered many long roads, and seen both the thralls of the barbarian north and the slaves of the scorching south. It sickens him, but he holds his temper. Such could hardly be said for Khazdor, whose eyes are starting to turn a faint purple with blood wrath, and none stand near him for the intense heat coming off him. Get me folk, and let's be gone afore I burn this forest to the ground, he snarls, flame licking about his every word. Andri leads the way as she scans the market. She is slightly disturbed by her own Blair's attitude towards the whole thing but ignores the feeling to focus on the task at hand. Soon, her keen eyes spy their target and she marches the party over. The dwarves from the mountain all lie in an enchanted slumber, unstirring like ones who are already dead. Despite the clearly violent resistance this indicates, the 12 are being bid up at remarkable speed. The small folk are clearly both a rarity and a prized commodity in this part of the world. The party quickly realizes even if they brought along their whole war chest, they'd not be able to purchase them. They begin to try to hurry up and think of a plan before Khazdor does something incredibly violent, but then the fatal word is spoken. Sold. The slumbering dwarves vanish into a small crystal near the center of their enclosure, which is handed off towards a tall Illyrian man in a garish orange suit who begins to depart. Kazdor follows with enough murderous intent that the air around him turns purple and everyone gets out of his way. Several armed guards begin to move in, but the garish Illyrian raises a hand to stop them and approaches the dragonborn. He doesn't get too close though, as Kazdor's eyes have gone blood red with fury, and his footsteps are glowing red in his wake. To say nothing of the pillar of barely contained chaotic wrath looming over the fairy. I do believe you're rather annoyed at my most recent purchase, aren't you, Kazdor of Order Undivided? The fairy says, and everyone takes a collective step backwards from the entire group, looking at them with the sort of awe you look at a forest fire or Tyrannosaurus Rex. The local area goes quiet, then becomes loud with the sound of whispering. Ye ken me fae laddie. So ye ken why exactly keeping a hold o' me kin is a very bad idea. Kazdor says. He does not raise his voice, but his words are carefully chosen, calmly spoken in a low tone. Julian's fingers begin twitching as he starts calculating how best to cut his way out of the arena. I know you all right, which is precisely why I bought these fine fellows. You couldn't afford them, but you'd certainly cause all manner of havoc trying to get them back, which is why I return them to you now, as a favor. He says with a smile, carefully handing over the crystal. Kazdor takes it and examines it carefully, suspecting a trick. He can sense the presence of his kin within it, and knows it would take only a flicker of will to release them and awaken them. This is far too easy. What's your game? He says warily. I do have a way you could repay me the favor, though this isn't the best place to chat. If you would, you can follow me. Or I can keep that favor for later use. The party is immediately wary. Following him would probably be a bad idea, but owing a favor the Sid would be significantly worse. Somewhat reluctantly, they follow, Kazdor cooling down substantially as they go. The Fae leads them back into the city and into a decently sized office which includes several employees. Various Illyrians sit at desks and chat, several comparing notes as they write out columns and articles. Julian actually recognizes it immediately. A newspaper? I didn't think this world had wide-scale printing presses yet. He says with no small amount of delight. The other five members of the party who haven't been to Eberron look at him very confused. I don't know what that is, so we probably don't plan Swalker. The orange-clad Illyrian says as he sits down at his own desk, labeled Cake on a Champerson. Fortunately, magic makes duplication and wide sales remarkably easy. I'm a shade confused, what's a newspaper? Senkit asks curiously. Sort of like those reports you get, but actually interesting to read and sold to the public at large to inform them about interesting events. Julian explains. HM, sounds useful. It is, I actually planned on setting one up in the various cities after we finish murdering all the current inhabitants. It would both inform the populace and enable me to control a substantial part of the local political narrative and cultural zeitgeist. Says the Arsima, with ambition slightly more naked than Senkit in her original armor. At least you're honest about your megalomania. Sen says with a shake of her head, she honestly expected this at this point. Julian gives back a grin that a devil would be proud of. We'll have to get in touch then, but for now, on to the small favor. Chamberson interrupts with a slight cough. Do you know where you just were, beyond a labor market? A racetrack, what's that got to do with it? Kazdor asks. A racetrack that is not bringing in the numbers it used to. Chamberson responds. It seems a lot of the newer immigrants and younger generations don't really enjoy it, never even gave it a chance, because they're just not interested in the competitors. I fail to see how this is your problem, let alone ours. Senkit responds bluntly. It's my problem because if nobody's interested in sports, nobody wants a sports section, and I'm the only paper in town with one. That and I owe the owner a favor. Always with the favors. Undry muses. So what do you want? As you may have guessed, you're all just a wee bit famous around here after the nonsense you've gotten into. You're really shaking up the mortal world and it's big news. I've sold out several times covering you all. The publisher says, pulling out a paper showing an artist's rendition of Julian's clash with York Wadord, and then another showing the party as a whole in action poses facing off against Avernius. The party are all fairly surprised at this, and their emotions range from annoyance to slight elation. You're really rather fellows to watch, and you wouldn't believe the amount of fairies running around keeping an eye on you to report back to some of your fans. This is a nightmare. An entire city of fairies watching me and Arnie Ken about it. Get to the point. You want us to endorse the racing track or something? Senkit asks, just wanting to get the business done. Not exactly. I want you to compete, specifically two of you in a special exhibition match to get people out to the races and see what happens. Me a chariot rider, none of us are. I am actually. Andri says, and the others turn. Elves still use them, it's faster than walking and I can drive, though I'm no racer. That's quite good, because the ones I think would bring the biggest crowd would be you and your slave friend Eort. The publisher says, drawing a start from the rest of the crowd. I mean the controversy, a slave and a noble on the same team, outsiders from a famous band coming in against established local champions, imagine the headlines and ticket sales. Your greed is disgusting. Senkit says bluntly. I'll do it. One condition. We keep the winnings if we win. Eort says, looking the slicer than the eye. And I get every piece of information you have on who owns Hobgoblin slaves and where. Kay looks back with a grin. Deal. The mess you'd make with that is going to be great news. What about you, Andri? Fine. Let's do it and be done. Andri says, arms crossed and a frown on her face. Right, the race will be 2 days from now, I'll see to your accommodations. The paladins leave with relish, and the publisher sits back in his chair and smiles. Knew they'd go for that, and the dwarves were cheaper than expected. Keep the extra. A voice says from the shadows as a masked woman quite literally steps out of them like a sailor disembarking from her ship. She is slender, but well built, clad all in dark blue and black, save for a demon-faced mask. She bears no weapons and needs none. It was rather easy to convince the other competitors to remove them. Well, it's a win all around then. That crash is going to be quite the pretty spike, and the young do so love their blood. Kay responds. It always is a pleasure working with the Iron Shadows.
Reroll is a great app available on the Apple and Google Play Store as well as desktop for creating beautiful 8-bit character art. The app has 14 supported races, 150 plus weapons, 400 plus armor pieces for you to mix and match, 20 plus mini bases. There is that much to work from. I was able to make Coldsteel the Hedgehog, the God Emperor of Mankind, Pepe, and they are always adding more artwork. The app also has a character sheet to help keep track of everything during games. And if that wasn't enough, you can play about with the app for free with limited artwork. So go ahead, check it out, and if you decide to buy the app, use promo code NICKBEDIA for 10% off and it lets them know we sent you. It's a great sponsor and a great app and we hope you guys go ahead and check it. But let's get back to the video.
Be me, Paladin, who sets up kings and governors. Because Dorgrudgy Bearer, Julian Warmaster, Peregrine the Redeemer, Andri of the Ancients, Eort the Treacherous, and Senkit the Devoted to Zeriel, Paladins of Order Undivided. The party departs the Solar Herald in search of lodgings to spend the night, as they're stuck here to pay back a favor to KKC, the publisher of the newspaper. As they start to roam about, they are surprised when a hawk soars in and lands in front of them. They all take a half step back as the bird's form shifts and warps into the form of an Illadrian page who kneels before them. Suzerain Imoth wishes to extend his invitation towards the noble warriors of Order Undivided to come to his court if you require lodgings. He explains, still not raising his head. Get up, laddie, tell your master we'll come and see him. Would be rude not to, Kazdor tells the boy. We will need directions though. Peregrine points out before the paid can leave. Of course, my lords, the Suzerain's palace is the central tower, it's the tallest one, so you can't miss it. The page explains, pointing towards the large white tower in the center of the city. The paladins thank him, and he flies off towards it. "Why did you accept that so quickly?" Julian asks. "It's ne courteous to refuse an invitation, especially from one prince to another. As dids, we need a bunkan is free in hospitality. You do recall we're dealing with the Fae here, right?" "Aye, which is precisely why we can I afford to be overly rude or discourteous. Normal nobles are bad enough, let alone elves." "He isn't wrong," Undri says with a slightly bemused smile. "Even when you're literally an inquisitor, elven nobles will still act haughty if you peeve them, though being able to have them burnt at the stake helped keep the worst snark away. Fine, let's go and see yet more smiling lions in their dens," Julian says rather exasperated as they walk on. "We walk into far less cheerful looking lions' dens on a regular basis, we've always gotten out fine," Peregrine says cheerfully. "You literally died last time, I don't think that qualifies as fine. I got better, so it all worked out in the end, no reason to get so upset about a little thing like death really," the unflappable halfling responds. The party enters the large spire's courtyard atop their mounts. This area is somewhat less populated, with mostly nobles and petitioners exchanging idle chit-chat as they wait their turn for the lord to see them. Many turn and stare though as the paladins enter, looking at them as though they just walked out of a storybook or off a stage. "Looks like we really are well known," Senkit says calmly. "I guess news spreads faster here than we realized. I mean, it's only been a few months since we took down Avernius," Peregrine mentions. "I guess that newspaper is fairly popular." The others ignore the stares and look around to see where they should head next. Another page rushes up to greet them and directs them inside ahead of the which draws a few annoyed glares, but most seem to understand. Once inside, they are quickly accosted by servants who direct them towards their rooms and offer them all manner of drinks and refreshments. The paladins wisely refuse. One thing they do not refuse though is a chance to wash the sweat and dust of their long travels from the roads. It seems this city was built on a series of hot springs, and so there are private baths in the palace, one for the men and one for the women. They are of course rather hesitant to relinquish their weapons, particularly Julian. So they soak the soreness and long miles of riding from their bones within arm's reach of a wide variety of deadly implements. Kazdor's great height actually proves to be a bit of an issue, as sitting down the water comes up only to his hips, so he instead lies down across the entire length of the pool. This is useful for Peregrine, who is so short that he has to stand to keep his head above water, who instead now sits on the slightly more elevated platform of Kazdor's legs. The ladies don't have much trouble in their side, although they do wind up in different pools as Senkit decides the water isn't quite hot enough. Undri decides to move about the time the water starts to simmer and is quite grateful when she sees the tiefling relaxing in a pool of boiling hot water, keeping the temperature up with a steady stream of hellfire. Sivrid meanwhile discovers an entirely new joy, specifically being ironed. If the cloak could speak, it would be groaning in satisfaction and enjoyment, and possibly discussing about this experience with the other clothing in the laundry. The cloak does notice one unusual thing about the cleaner though. This isn't a fairy or a fae, it instead gives off the same sort of feeling as Undri, probably another moon elf. The party emerges from their baths to find something intensely suspicious. There are clothes laid out for them, each kind exactly tailored to their size. They simply put their armor back on rather than risk putting those on. Thus, cleaned and ready to meet with the suzerain, they head out, save Peregrine, who slips away. They enter a large, spacious grand hall with a wooden floor, high marble walls painted with pictures of great battles and equally great feasts, lit by sunlight fading in from several windows. An impressive feat considering this room is in the center of the spire and nowhere near the edges, not to mention windows set into a rectangular room in a circular building. The room includes all manner of strange folk. A wolf man standing upright, clad in dark greens and black, with a bow on his back, Illadine of all four seasons, bickering in pairs of summer and winter or spring and autumn. Ladies and men of the court clad in fine silks or shining chain, with rapiers resting at their hips, a dragonborn, tiefling, halfling, moon elf, and are similar clad like paladins. Wait a second, what? The paladins all do a double take, and stare in shock at the mirror images of themselves minus Yort. Cause Dor goes for his axes. Alright, ye've got 3 seconds to explain this devilry. He warns, and the room goes tense. The dragonborn copy of Kaz raises his hands in a gesture of peace. I really did get your voice completely wrong. Sorry, I simply thought it would be a good jest. The creature explains, as it shrinks and changes into a humanoid with grey skin, hair, and eyes, with a completely unremarkable and unmemorable face. The rest of the company does the same. Doppelgangers. Julian says with a raised eyebrow. Not surprising to see among the Fae, but certainly surprising to be seen so openly. If you're implying we're assassins or spies, you're incorrect. I am Lul of the Many-Faced Acting Company, these are my compatriots Ciro, Nyula, Ling, and Sifire. A pleasure to actually meet the subjects of one of our shows for once, albeit a surreal one. Nyul explains. Surreal? I've been called many things, but that's a new one. Senkit says, slightly confused. How would you feel if you actually ran into either Lo, or Juliet, or Achilles? Ciro, the actress? Actor? Gender is hard with shapeshifters, I'm going to go with actress. Absolutely nothing, I have no idea who those people are. Senkit says. Having come from Chult, she is devoid of the same cultural background as the rest of the party. Never mind, still, a pleasure to meet you, and I told you he'd have a Dwarvish accent. Ciro says, digging an elbow into her leader's side. Oh. We haven't had any dwarves in this part of the world since my grandfather was here. I didn't have anything to work with. The troop leader says with a shrug. Say, aren't we short a fellow, or did Peregrine gain quite a few inches? Ling asks. The party looks around, somewhat surprised at the halfling's disappearance. Uh-oh. They say almost in unison. I'll go find him. Yort says, slipping off and vanishing under his spell of invisibility. Handy, him having that power. Means we can skimp on extras for the fight scenes. Nahl comments. We appear to be quite well known, any particular reason why? Andri asks. It's mostly this one bard, strange fellow that human. He's been writing about you for a few months now. I'm going to have to meet this bard. Julian grumbles. Good luck. Nobody's managed to actually track him down or figure out how he's writing all this, but between him and the Solas reporting, you're somewhat famous. Before the conversation can continue, they are interrupted by the sound of a trumpet announcing the return of the Lord. Many kneel, but those of rank only bow respectfully. Julian does neither, nor does Andri. Senkit inclines her head respectfully, but does not bow, and Kazdor raises a fist to his chest in a dwarven salute. The lord who enters is a tall Eladrine, clad all in silver and green in a fine set of robes he wears over shining mithril chain. On his head is a silver crown forged like twisting vines. In his hand is a scepter of living wood crowned with amber, and at his hilt is a long blade that gleams with obvious and cold magic. Suzerain Imoth takes his seat upon his throne, with two guards wielding halberds standing on either side of him. All rises his gesture, and he directs his gaze towards Julian. You do not bow, nor even incline your head nor salute me. Why? He asks. Your subjects should indeed kneel, your vassals bow, and those who know you and offer you respect, either for the office of the crown or for yourself salute you. I am not sworn to you, nor do I consider crowns to be of any worth, nor do I know you. Therefore, you are but a man, same as I. Why would I bow? Julian answers eloquently and boldly. Well said, and as for you, sister? He asks Andri. Bowing would indicate some level of service to you, saluting indicate a respect towards you. Considering my office, neither would be appropriate. Even lords and kings are under the eyes of the gods, and should it prove necessary, it would not do for a vassal or respectful friend to burn you for heresy. The Inquisitor answers, in a manner that seems rehearsed, or perhaps simply something that she has said quite often. The suzerain nods. It has been many years since one of your order has walked these halls, Inquisitor. I pray that the gods send you that our faith might be confirmed, for I have not strayed from the Maker's path. May it be so. Andre answers him, and the ritual concludes, both relaxing slightly. The necessary dance of court out of the way, the suzerain smiles, and rises. Ladies and gentlemen of the court, I am pleased to welcome our most prestigious guests, order undivided. The room rings with applause as the Lord takes his seats. I had not expected our halls to be graced with such a superb band, though I see one of your members is absent. 2. Kazdor corrects him. Eort is a member full, let me say otherwise. There is a small bit of grumbling from the fey contingents, but the Lickan nods approvingly. The king and the prince look one another eye to eye for a moment, and the fairy blinks first. 2. Then, my apologies. In any case, I would know why you came here. Some of our folk were taken. We came to get them back, Senkit says. For as well known as we seem to be, you apparently have no concerns with kidnapping those under our protection. The suzerain gives a nervous smile. Apologies, Lady Abbess, but you are only 5, and while a mighty band, by what right do you claim dominion over all those who have entered these lands, by rights as Lord Commander of the Ordanic Union? Julium says, stepping forwards. The colonists, dwarves included, are citizens of a dominion under our protection. The court takes a collective gasp, and even the suzerain looks taken aback. It apparently had not yet occurred to them that the paladins had formed a country, one with a very strong de jure claim on its citizens. Several Illadrines start edging away from the sides of the court nervously, particularly the wealthiest ones. The suzerain looks at him carefully, looking right into his eyes, and then his brow crinkles in confusion. Our glasses. He mutters quietly, before shaking his head to clear it. Ah, well, we were unaware of your new state, as it were. You must understand. Oh, I understand plain well you habit o enslaved folk like your black-skinned cousins. Kazdor growls, and the suzerain rises from his seat. Amber eyes and clear, cold sapphires meet, judging one another, then the fey laughs and takes his seat again. You have the same look in your eyes as a king who loves his people does. Your little nation will need a flag and an army, but you really have made a nation of it, and believed it to be so before there was a document or a banner. He chuckles. You might not want to try that with a mortal, they tend to be too legalistic to believe you're a nation just by your ideals, but then again you are paladins. Your ideals are remarkably impressive things to watch. Ah, Omni King, none of us are. Not de facto, but here we judge by hearts, and you're a king whether you call yourself one or not, though whether that's diplomatic or a deeply held belief may vary. He says, looking at Julian out of the corner of his eye. The War Master looks back at him with no expression, which makes the fairy chuckle even more. Well then, how about this? Since I'd rather not have to expend the rather substantial amount of coin and effort it would take to get rid of you, an agreement. If your folk wear a banner and stay out of the Feywild, we won't bother them. Start infringing on fairy though and you're fair game. An acceptable deal. We have no need to expand into fairy in any case. Julian responds. Good, that ought to keep your folk from being bothered and my folk from being smitten when we annoy you and draw you into murder and burn anything in your way like you have every other nation that's bothered you, the fey says. Blunt, but not inaccurate. Senkit says approvingly. An aide rushes up and whispers in the suzerain's ear, and the fairy snorts. Well, that explains where your 5th member has gone. Oh? Andre asks. It appears you have invaded my kitchens. I for one welcome our new hobbit overlord.
No tabletop RPG is complete without beautiful models on the table, and the best place to get models is from us. If you check the link below, we have everything you could need for your magical realm. Only the finest of big titty wafers here. But if you're not into models or don't play with models, we got you covered with subclasses such as the Gachimashi Wizards, the Simp Warlock and the North FC Fighter. Also, we have started selling 5th edition adventures, with our first one featuring Belle Delphine, the succubus that has poisoned the town's well and turned the villagers into simps. If any of that stuff sounds fun to you, go ahead and check the link below, but let's get back to the video.
Be me, Paladin and Circus Master Maximus, because Dor the Wrestler, Andre the Charioteer, Senkit the Marathoner, Peregrine the Fencer, Julian the Chess Master, and the Ord the Javelin Thrower. Paladins of Order Undivided who would all probably do extremely well in professional sports. The party rests in the Hall of Suzerainimith of the Wild Fae City of Elvercurren, preparing for an upcoming race to pay back a favor to a certain mustache-eyed newspaper editor. Having encountered the local lord and a troop of doppelgangers, the party heads off to their rooms, except Julian, who stays behind and engages the doppelgangers in idle chit-chat. On their way back, Kazdor follows his nose down towards the kitchens to find an exasperated-looking Eort and a grinning Peregrine, already in his chef's hat. Kaz, thank the gods, this tiny tyrant is absurdly picky, and I sincerely regret offering to help him, please help. Eort begs. I am not, I simply have a higher standard of meals than cornbread and fried ham. The halfling responds from behind a steaming bowl of soup. It was fine when we were on the move, it's fine now. We didn't have a kitchen or anything but that dang fish, or Andre's torture peppers which she brought along for some reason. Kaz leaves the two squabbling cooks chuckling. He knows better than to get involved in that, for there shall soon be much shouting and flinging of foods and cutlery. He flicks his mind towards Sivrid, who is busy simply relaxing in the sunlight coming in from a window nearby. Wah, ye awake ye great lazy flappers. MMMPH, unfortunately yes thanks to you, I'm sleeping here after a truly wonderful experience with a magnificent woman. Seg responds. If Kazdor had eyebrows, and could blush through already quite red scales, he would be even redder, and his eyebrows would be orbiting Jupiter. Wait, ye can, what now? How in the nine hells? I was ironed. I'm a pair of wings that is occasionally a cloak, it's literally impossible for me to get busy since that's what you're thinking. Kazdor facepalms. Ye could have phrased it a lot better, laddie. Probably. I take it you're still headed this way? Aye, this probably unwise tale leave ye hanging about. Right, right, I'll meet you soon, the wings mutter back with the attitude of a cat that has to get up and do something before sliding off its hook and gliding over to meet up with Kaz and slide back on. The pair head back towards the Dragonborn's accommodation, and so Kazdor never sees the coal black elf watching curiously as the cloak he just finished ironing gets up and flies off. Regardless, the cleaning drow shrugs it off and gets back to his washing. Andre takes a moment just to enjoy being back in a proper elven room again, even if it is in a city not at all to her liking. The guest room is two floors up, with a large window overlooking the city through which the light of the setting sun filters through. A soft bed with clean linen sits in one corner, but the room is broadly open, tastefully decorated with fine embroidery and landscape portraits. For a moment, she simply sits down and begins to meditate, enjoying the warm sunlight and the sound of the wind blowing by. The worries of the day, the race, her past, and what come next are carefully picked up and put to the side. They're still there, but for a few precious moments she simply enjoys the day. Her tranquil state of mind is disrupted slightly as she hears footsteps stop outside her door. She ignores it at first, then hears the handle turn. She opens her eyes slightly, tranquil calm forsaken as she watches the door's reflection in the mirror through eyes that look closed. She observes with the quiet intensity of a predator as the door opens, and her heart nearly stops. She is on her feet in a blur, power whirling about her as she draws her knife from her boot and the backup knife from her other boot. Towels, her freshly cleaned traveling clothes, and a quite nice bathrobe go flying as Andre closes the distance between her and the intruder in seconds, knocking them from his hands and throwing him across the hallway into the opposite wall. Andre lunges forwards and traps her enemy's neck between her blades as silver vines like spider silk bind him to the wall. Her eyes flicker back and forth down the hallway, then up towards the ceiling and back towards the doorway, fearing more could come through the window. Where are the others? You scum never attack alone and they certainly wouldn't just send a male. What are your plans for the others, and how did you get in this city? The Inquisitor hisses, amethyst eyes blazing with terror and hatred into petrified red ones set into a dark-skinned face. I don't know what you're talking about. I'm just the launderer. My only plans were to deliver your clothes and not get murdered. The drow protests, looking about and hoping somebody will come and save him from the clearly insane moon elf. Andri sees the clothes now strewn across the floor. Her eyes flicker twice, first checking for magic, then for poison. Then she turns the various scattered pieces of cloth over, fully expecting to find a snake or spider or some other venomous surprise. The only thing she finds is some superbly well done laundry. Her clothes are as good as new, hells, he even patched some of the holes they'd gotten worn in them. There must be something, some trick, some lie, some ambush waiting, she'd just need to beat it out of the puny male. How dare he lie to her? She starts to turn with an expression that makes him cringe, reminded a bit too much of the stories he was told when he was young of the terrible priestesses who lived deep beneath the ground. Andri looks at his fear and feels satisfaction, as though she has achieved a certain degree of payback on the demons who ravaged her and her city. She should just kill him right now and hunt down the rest after she watched him bleed out. Then, like a child who is caught by their parent burning ants with a magnifying glass, she feels an intense wave of disappointment. As though her mother had placed a hand on her shoulder and shook her head disapprovingly. She staggers back, weakened and dizzy. Her magic fails, completely and utterly. The vines turn to silver dust, freeing the drow who quickly begins to try to regather the clothing before anyone comes along and sees this. Andri looks at her hands as an incredible weakness rushes through her whole body. She feels feverish, nauseous. Poison? No, it felt like she was getting sick, but she hadn't been sick since she was a child. Her vision swam, and she raised her hand to her head, trying to call on magic to cleanse her of poisons, but no magic comes, there is no connection, nothing there at all. Andri starts to panic, then turns and throws up, vomiting up black bile. These don't match any symptoms of any poison she knows, and she knows plenty. The world goes dark, and the floor rushes up to meet her as the blight claims her. The paladins pound through the halls to Andri's room, everything they were currently doing forgotten. The moon elf lies in her bed, her pale skin deathly white as a vampire. Her veins have turned black and engorged, and while they pour healing and curative magic into her, it only just barely makes progress. Senkit goes for more water and clean cloths, trying to beat back the fever. Kazdor sanitizes the ones that they already have in his personal supply of alcohol and then uses his body heat to dry them. Julian and Bust pore over their books and confer at the speed of thought as the cat and Arsimer examine the dying elf, mixing together herbs and elixirs to desperately try to combat the symptoms. Eort stands guard over the room, not trusting the Fae. They have no idea why this is happening to Andri, and they aren't taking any chances. Peregrine sits with the extremely anxious drow in the next room, speaking calmly and without condemnation. What's your name? Tirith, I swear this isn't my fault, I swear on the moon and stars. He says. His breath is rapid, he's sweating bullets from fear. I haven't said it is. Peregrine reassures him before pouring him a cup of tea. Breathe in for 4 seconds, then exhale for 8 seconds. Repeat this while the leaves steep. He advises the panicked servant, who complies. To his amazement, it calms him. Peregrine slides over the tea. So tell me, what happened? The halfling asks. I don't entirely know. I went to deliver the laundry, and then she just attacked me. She had me tied to the wall with some kind of magic with her knives at my throat, then she looked like she was about to gut me just to watch me bleed. He says, shuddering at the memory. Then, she got sick and fell unconscious, so I put her in the bed and ran to get the rest of you. Wait, so how did you get out of the bindings? Peregrine asks. They vanished just before she got sick. I've never seen anyone fall ill so quickly. Peregrine's face grows concerned, and the cold grip of fear takes the rare opportunity to gently caress his heart. Oh no, Andri, what have you done? Andri opens her eyes in darkness, with fragmented strands of moonlight all about her. She sits up, looking around. She stands up and begins to walk forwards, looking at the strands. She reaches out and touches one. She falls back and finds herself standing in an audience in the midst of a great hall, one she knows well. It was in this hall that she trained, she grew, she swore her oaths. But that hall was burned, decades ago. She looks about and is shocked to see a young initiate with hair already as white as an elder kneeling before the altar, then she sees the figure next to her. It is a tall elven man, with skin tanned by many years of wandering. His features are handsome, exceptionally masculine. His is broad and visibly strong, and he wears a full suit of black armor which gleams with enchantments. On his back is the halberd of the captain of the guard, and at his side is a far more dangerous weapon, his spellbook. Elaithm. She hisses, but she also remembers how he forsook that visage when he betrayed them. He hadn't worn that face since. Wait, that girl. Oh, this is a memory. She says, wondering if perhaps she has finally achieved trance for the first time, though she can't recall ever hearing about seeing the events in third person. The younger Undri speaks. By the ancient earth, by the moon and the stars, by the maker and his shadow my goddess I thus swear. Ah, so these were my oaths. Undri muses. I shall kindle the light, that it may shine brightly to guide and to hold back the dark. Undri's world lurches and spins as she flies forwards. She sees herself again, this time in the much more recent past in her duel against the werewolf. She watches as the past her drives the burning silver into the beast man over and over, sees her face twisted in sadistic glee. No, I wasn't like that. She raises her voice in protest, but deep inside, she fears she is lying. The paladins give a start as Undri begins to twitch and spasm in her sleep. They turn her to the side so that if she vomits she won't choke. Her fever increases drastically. The paladins move quicker, Julian trying to make her take a new elixir, but she won't keep it down. Undri is back before the altar, her younger self speaks again. I shall shelter the light and defend all that is good in the world. The vision shifts, and the crowd vanishes. Nothing but the girl remains, and then she becomes a marble statue, which grows in size and looms over Undri, who steps back as the void returns, held back only by the light emanating from the statue. I shall kindle my own light, that the evil of the world might not overcome it, her younger voice speaks, and then a rapid set of flashbacks hit her in succession. Dozens of moments over and over, starting from her departure from her home after the battle, visibly cracked and battered. Then 50 years of anger, fear, and steadily growing bitterness from a lifetime of wounds. The statue dims with each rapid memory, cracking, crumbling, distorting as the light fades and the dark closes in. In the waking world, Undri's convulsions become even more violent until the party has to work together to hold her down as the dark veins thicken and become more pronounced. Julian cuts open a vein and uses Mitch's hand to force the medicine inside like a syringe. Undri's blood flows black, and slowly, as though it were half clotted. The statue crumbles, and Undri sees what the laundry drowse saw before her oath strength left her entirely. A white-haired demoness with a sadistic glare straight out of the demon web pits. I shall be the light in the darkness against evil. Her own oath damns her, before the statue shatters entirely and black vines seize her and drag her into the dark. In the waking world, Andri's body spasms and goes stiff, her mouth foaming and her heart nearly beating out of its chest as it tries to force coagulated blood through her veins. The party realizes they're losing her and channel every bit of healing magic they have left to try to keep her alive. You know this isn't entirely fair. She isn't evil, she's sick. Her mind is damaged by what happened to her. A dark mother speaks. I'm well aware of the consequences your people inflicted on her. It caused the relapse, better just to let her die and let the next life hopefully keep her away from anything like that. An older, colder woman responds. So, this is your mercy then? Kill her and help. The girl has no idea what she is, you and the Maker made certain I couldn't offer her any help, even though she still remembers me. She's an elf now, not that thing you rescued. You do the exact same thing, you know, condemn people whole scale. You hate them too, so judging her for hating is simply hypocritical. I'm not the one who has a lifetime topped by chaos to answer for. Neither is she, unless your legendary moon door isn't half of what it's cracked up to be. You're risking making me angry, why do you care so much for this one? If I didn't care for my children, I wouldn't have made the deal to get them to you in the first place. Besides, you know what's coming and who is still there. Do you really want to risk removing one of the key pieces just as the end game is beginning? She broke her oath. You let her be broken. She can hear us, you know. The first time she can hear the goddess she devotes her life to, and you condemn her. Don't guilt trip me, traitor. You know the code. I know part of that oath includes forgiveness as well. I also happen to know the local area offers a certain opportunity for a test now that she has been made aware of her error. The fact that it took this to make her aware somewhat proves my point. The fact that you still call me traitor even after everything I've done to fix what my mother broke proves mine. I have to ask again, what's your endgame? Why does this rescue matter so much? Her soul will lead others home and bring back something that you very conveniently allowed to be forgotten. You can't be sure of that. If there was even a chance of a single one, I'd still be trying. You would, wouldn't you? A test then. Andri opens her eyes and looks around. Her weapons are in her hands, and she's underground, in a stalactite city. Many other high elves move around her, fighting against their dark kin, Mitral against adamantine, Moonlight against demonic power, clashing and twisting arcane. A drow soldier rushes at her, and she cuts him down. Andri fights, and she fights, and she keeps fighting, until it becomes a blur. She raises her head from the blur of battle. With a group of other soldiers, she stands inside one of the great palaces of the drow nobles. A lone female stands against her, guarding a door. The two let out a cry to their goddesses and come against each other, mason whip against saber and knife. Andri kicks the priestess back, having delivered two strong blows. The priestess stands up, with the same kind of stubborn determination that she loved seeing in Senkit. It just makes her even angrier to see it on a drow. They clash again, and Andri sweeps her leg low, dropping the drow onto her back defenseless. Andri raises her blades to finish her, when movement from the door catches her eye. A young drow, barely even an adolescent, steps out, carrying a sword too big for her. The child looks at her mother, who looks back and offers her words of reassurance. The drow are good liars, and so she lies and tells her daughter it's going to be okay. Andri turns and cuts down to finish off the priestess when a new memory hits her. She reels back, badly bloodied and weak, her weapons are gone, and she turns, calling on a kind of magic she never has before. The spell is left incomplete, as two swords strike her in the heart. She sinks low and raises up a bloodied hand to touch her son's face, even as her body breaks apart, dissolving into silver light. Andri regains her senses, her blades at the drow priestess's throat, still shaking off the memory. The young drow charges to save her mother, and Andri strikes. With the flat of her blade, knocking the priestess unconscious and disarming the child, still breathing heavily and distracted. What was that? Her son. She had no children. And her heart, a wound like that was fatal. The dream fades away, and Andri holds fast to the memory, even the memory of her last life's death. It was something. She had once had a son, and the son had killed her. There was something there, something at least. The paladins, several nearly about to collapse from exhaustion, nearly weep with relief as Andri's magic returns, and the blight is banished. Her blood vessels return to normal, she cools, and her body lies restful. Julian sits down, tears running down his face and dripping onto the floor as Andri stirs. He wipes his eyes, but they're still clearly red. He stands up to check on her, and she smiles at him as she opens his eyes. You cried? Jules, I didn't realize you had a heart at all. She jokes at him, but sees his still concerned face. I'll be okay. The drow attacked, You didn't hurt him, this was my own fool fault. She says, but Julian isn't listening. He is far too concerned with the cataracts that have appeared in Andri's eyes, like crescent moons, pointing down.
Well guys, hope you enjoy today's video. We are going to assume you have if you have stayed to the end. Consider subscribing and clicking the notification bell if you really enjoyed it to stay up to speed with any and all new videos. Also check out the links below to our shop for some fat ass titties and our sponsor Rural, and be sure to use a promo code at checkout so they know we sent you and you'll get 10% off. And until next time.